وقال الله تبارك وتعالى أم حسبتم أن تدخلوا الجنة ولما يأتكم مثل الذين خلوا من قبلكم مسهم البأساء والضراء وزلزلوا حتى يقول الرسول والذين آمنوا معه متى نصر الله ألا إن نصر الله قريب. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أشد الناس بلاء الأنبياء ثم الأمثل فالأمثل. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لقد بخلت في الله ما لا يقال احد ولقد مضيت في الله ما لا يرى احد. وقال عليه الصلاه والسلام امتي هذه امه مرحومه ليس عليها عذاب في الاخره عذابها في الدنيا الفتن والزلازل والقتل أو كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم صدق الله العظيم وبلغنا رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك ومن الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين. I will humbly request the Lord be Guru Sharif اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم يا رب صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك سيد الخلق كلهم. أما بعد, our most respected and honored and the president of the Jamiah Mawlana with one ambassador, Darul Qatar, the president of Ali, Hafiz, all the ulama kiram, our respected brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. One of the wonderful privileges of me is to speak upon is indeed the seerah of the Jamiah Mawlana, alayhi wa sallam. Why I say it is a very difficult subject to speak about is because a person doesn't really know where to start and where to end. It's an ocean. And how does one encompass an ocean? It's not possible to encompass the ocean. So, from that point of view, it is very difficult to speak on the seerah. Secondly, what qualification do we really have to speak on the seerah? Who are we and what is our standing to speak about the greatest and most honored personality that ever set foot on the surface of the earth, upon whom the sun ever shone, Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A poet said very beautifully regarding anyone who writes or speaks about Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he cannot do justice to the subject matter of the seerah. He is not praising Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In reality, it is himself that is becoming worthy of praise and acceptance by speaking about the life of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The poet said in Arabic very beautifully, مَا إِن مَدَحْتُ مَا إِن مَدَحْتُ مُحَمَّدًا بِمَقَالَتِي مَا إِن مَدَحْتُ مُحَمَّدًا بِمَقَالَتِي وَلَكِن مُدِحَتْ مَقَالَتِي بِمُحَمَّدٍ. It is not that Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has been praised by my words, that my words became worthy of praise because the name of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was part and parcel of my speech, or his biography became part and parcel of my speech or my writings. So alhamdulillah, we are here today, and first of all, I am very grateful to the organizers of this conference for including me and as a student in this gathering to present on the seerah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this some kind of provision for us all, those who are presenting and those who are present. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this a izar and a kind of a provision for us that we can take and present on the day of Qiyamah. Amongst the things that we can present is the fact that the love of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is what brought us here. It is what made us sit here, and it is what made us to be part of this gathering on a rainy Saturday night we could have been doing so many other things. But we chose to be here on this occasion. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our coming here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward the organizers for including us in this wonderful and excellent initiative. And I also want to be, I want to express my gratitude to them for giving me an open-ended subject or a topic of my choice. Alhamdulillah, the ulama have done a splendid job, but they were perhaps constrained in a sense that they were given topics up front, so they had to remain within the framework of the topic that was given to them. But I was given advantage, I would say, being perhaps a guest from another province, I was given a little bit of liberty that I could choose and select my own subject matter, and that made it difficult in a sense also, that where do we start and what do we touch upon. But I chose to speak about the subject of the challenges, the hardships and the difficulties faced by Rasul Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the lessons for a suffering ummah. I chose this particular topic because we are living in very difficult and challenging times. We are living in times when there is a tendency in certain segments of the ummah to become very despondent and to begin to despair. And people are beginning to lose hope. People are beginning to question the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are questioning where is the help of Allah. People are beginning to question the veracity of what we have been taught, that the help and assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be with the Muslim ummah. Because in the last few decades, or perhaps over a century, all we are seeing is the continuous downfall of the ummah. We are seeing the ummah as if it is free fall, falling down. And we don't get any optimism, we don't get any good news, we don't get any kind of encouraging news. So there is a kind of a spirit of pessimism and this kind of despair that has gripped the ummah. And this is something that is dangerous. Therefore, from time to time, we need to rectify this. And we always need to see that silver lining on the dark cloud. And what better for that than in the seerah of the beloved Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. As I said, we are living in a time that we only hear the devastating news, heart-wrenching news of how Muslims have been massacred. There was genocide, there was ethnic cleansing, thousands and thousands, more than a million now will be homeless. They'll be in this, you know, rain. Imagine somebody outside in the soaking, drenching rain. There's no shelter, there's no cover, there is no home, there's no clothes, there's no nothing of comfort. And to live such a miserable and abject life, this is the dismal picture, for example, that we see of the Rohingya Muslims at this point in time. Allah SWT make it easy for them. Make it easy for the Muslims of Syria. More than half the population have become refugees. Largest number of refugees in the world from any country in Syria, scattered all over the world, in most difficult and abject conditions. They were people like you and I. They had everything in life, and overnight they lost it all. And the greatest fear and challenge at this point in time is the onslaught on the aqidah and the iman and the belief. Many have been taken to the Western world, European countries, to America and so on, and a concerted effort has been made to take them out of Deen al-Islam and to introduce them to some other kind of religions. And that would be the greatest tragedy of all, that we lost everything from a worldly point of view, but we have to lose the most dear and beloved thing and the greatest possession of a believer, that is the right of Iman, then what is left after that? And this is really one of the great difficulties that we face when these kind of upheavals happen, that it not only affects we sitting far away as spectators, we feel the pain and the agony and the suffering of those people. Can you imagine the people who are right in the middle of it? How they must be feeling. So therefore, we have to constantly refer back to the seerah of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, And you have to go through all the difficulties and hardships that you went through. And in that you will find inspiration, and in that you will find hope, and inshallah you will find optimism in that. So this is why I selected this particular topic for discussion, to speak about the lessons, the difficulties and hardships of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam throughout his life, from the very inception of his life till the point of his demise and death. There wasn't a day we could see that everything was easy going and it was plain sailing. Every day there was some kind of difficulty, some kind of challenge, some kind of hardship that the Akram Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam faced. So inshallah, if we look into that, then we will get that consolation. Mawlana Tunara, mashallah, gave a very inspiring presentation before me, and you alluded to one particular incident. You alluded to the incident of that Sahabiya, the lady in the Battle of Uhud, when she was informed, it was said to her, "Qutila Abu, your father has been killed." She didn't react. Then it was said to her, "Qutila Ibnu, your son has been killed." But she did not react. Then it was said to her, "Qutila Zawju, your husband has been killed." And she did not react. And she then asked, that what is the condition of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? And when she was informed that he is well, then she uttered a statement, and perhaps that should be a slogan for the Ummah today. The statement of that Sahabiya. She was not a known person, they don't even have her name recorded in the books of Hadith. But what a statement. She said, "Kullu shay'in ba'daka jalalun ya Rasulullah. Kullu shay'in ba'daka hayyun ya Rasulullah." If you are alive, then everything else after that is nothing. We can deal with anything. And the implication of the statement is also that after the demise of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, there cannot be any tragedy that can be greater than the Ummah will face than the demise of Nabi Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So even if the whole Ummah has to be massacred and slaughtered and killed, it cannot be equated to the demise of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and he's leaving this world. So in all of this, there is a lot of inspiration, and there is a lot of hope, and there is optimism for the Ummah. So now inshallah, we will speak briefly, since this is a Seerah conference, we will look at this from that perspective, the perspective of the hardships of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam as a subject matter for discussion. Now we look at the glimpses of the hardships of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam when he came to his childhood. The first thing, the fact that he was born an orphan, not even have the shadow of a father over him when he was born, that itself tells you that he entered this world with a difficulty and hardship upon himself. And when the years of his life had passed, I'm trying to be as brief as possible, inshallah. This subject matter itself is very vast. It's very vast, but I'll just touch upon certain salient aspects of it. Then we know that those years of his childhood, imagine what must have gone through his sensitive and beloved heart, that he would have seen so many children around him who had fathers, and he had to live with this thought and reality that he wouldn't have even seen his father and would never know what it is to have a father. Then we know that when he came to selecting the children from Makkah, all the women selected their children from wealthy home, and nobody wanted to take Nabi Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Nobody. It was in the good fortune of Halima radiallahu ta'ala anha. Maybe in the beginning it was by reluctance that she took him, but it was her good fortune that when she did take him, Allah Akbar, how the blessings of Allah poured upon her. In this world and even in the hereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted her resting place in Jannatul Baqi. Amongst the kubur where ziyarat is made, there is the qabr of Sayyidina Halima Sahiya radiallahu ta'ala anha, that Allah ta'ala granted her resting place in Jannat al-Baqi. She had grown iman on Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam accorded the greatest respect for the fact that she was his foster mother. So we see that the childhood days, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has a distinct disadvantage of not having a father, and hence not coming from a wealthy family and wealthy background. People did not want to even take him up in the beginning days. And thereafter, the many difficult moment of his life when he lost his beloved mother, and it was only him and Umbe Ayman, just two souls traveling, returning from Medina, going back to Makkah. His mother pining to go to the grave of his father Abdullah, who is buried in Medina Munawwara. And according to some narrations, some scholars have even identified the exact place of his qabr. But that is a technical, academic discussion, so I will not want to go into that. But now, on the return journey, they pass through a locality called Aqwa, and that is where the grief was so overwhelming in the heart of Amina that she could not bear that grief anymore, separation from her husband Abdullah. And she breathed her last in this very place, Aqwa, and beloved Rasulullah, with his own little hands, a six-year-old child, takes the beloved Rasulullah's mother and he places her in the grave. And with his little hands, he covers that grave himself and Umbe Ayman. And Umbe Ayman says that I will never forget that sight when the little Muhammad, he falls onto the grave of his mother and he sobs and cries so much that the ground of the soil, the soil of the grave is wetted with the tears of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That now the only support that he had in life, that he was full of support, his mother had passed on. And then he comes to Makkah Mukarramah, and can you imagine how much of trauma he went through in this tender young life of his. Then he loses his grandfather Abdul Muttalib, and then he's brought up by his uncle Abu Talib. And those early years of his life, we can imagine how his heart must have been so broken and shattered that all the pillars of support, father, mother, grandfather, who then taken the place of father, just within 2 years after the demise of his mother, also leave this world. So this is the glimpse of the early childhood of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And all the orphan children of the world can take inspiration from this, that if we have lost our mothers and fathers, then there is nothing to be grieved, because the mother of Allah also went through this phase in his life. We say to all the young children of Syria and of Palestine and of the Rohingya Muslim, of Arakan, and of the Muslim children, Muslim children from all over the world, that do not lose heart, for the best of the best also grew up in this world as a yatim, as an orphan. Then we go to another phase in the life of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam now, as he comes to adulthood, or in fact even in his teenage years, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is faced with challenges. Now he doesn't have anyone to financially support him, but subhanallah, he does not rest on his laurels and become a kind of a parasite on his uncle Abu Talib, was already burdened with the responsibility of supporting a big family. We find that the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam stands up on his own feet. And what does he do? He takes on a menial task. He takes on a menial task of becoming the shepherd of the wealthy people of Makkah, tending to their animals and taking care of the animals and taking them out and grazing them in the fields. This is the occupation that Nabi Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam takes on as a teenager, as a youngster, so that he would earn for himself and support himself. Qira'at, it is mentioned in the books of Hadith also, that for just a few, small amount, a paltry amount, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam undertook this task. And in this way, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala also made his tanbiyah that every Nabi of Allah was in fact made a shepherd. And Allah directly makes the tanbiyah of the Anbiya alayhi salam. أَدَّبَنِي رَبِّي فَأَحْسَنَ تَعْدِيمِ وَعَلَّمَنِي رَبِّي فَأَحْسَنَ تَعْدِيمِ. Allah is the one who taught me, Allah is the one who nurtured me. Anbiya alayhi salam there's no teacher for the Ambiya alayhi salam. There is no murabbi for the Ambiya alayhi salam other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the signs of a false prophet is somebody who has been tutored and taught by someone else. The Ambiya alayhi salam are not tutored by anyone, nor are they taught or nurtured by anyone. They are taught and nurtured directly by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala nurtured Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this manner. In the footstep of all his august brothers, the Ambiya alayhi salam, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam became a shepherd of animals. And it is through this training that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then made them the shepherds of their nations and their ummahs. Nevertheless, this again is an inspiration for many young people perhaps who have lost everything in life, they've lost their source of livelihood. Take our brothers and sisters from the Rohingya Muslims who are coming into Bangladesh. Right now, there's no source of livelihood, there's nothing. How do they earn? How do they support their families and so on? So here we see that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in those difficult conditions, he took on the most menial of tasks just so that he could support himself. And like that, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam undertook three journeys to Syria and two journeys that he undertook. And in other words, he was willing to take on difficulties and hardships. He did not sit back and say, well, you know, I should feel sorry for myself. I got no father, I got no mother, I got no grandfather, I got nobody to support me. So people should feel sorry for me and help me and assist me. No, subhanAllah, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was a paragon of self-reliance and of strength. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam undertaking these difficult journeys, but not easy to travel in those areas. You didn't just buy a ticket and hop onto a plane and land in a destination and return. There were long, arduous journeys that had to be undertaken. So this was a glimpse of some of the aspects of the hardships and difficulties that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam faced in his adulthood. There were also the difficulty he faced in living in the corrupt environment of Makkah. His heart was absolutely pure and clean. And for him to live in the midst of oppression, in the midst of tyranny, in the midst of exploitation, at the midst of idol worship, and immorality and shamelessness, this was a very great difficulty for the people of Islam, because his heart could not bear all these vices that were present at that time. And so he would take refuge in the cave of Hira, in the Jabal al-Nur, the mountain of light, for long periods of time, so that he could be spared the vices and the evil environment of Makkah Mukarrama. Okay, let me move on to another phase of great difficulty and hardship in the life of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and that was at the time of Nubuwwat, when Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala entrusted him with that responsibility of Nubuwwat. Then we know that at that time, first of all, the very experience of the first wahi, how awesome it was, and how weighty and difficult it was upon the heart of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that he actually felt that perhaps his soul will leave his body. That's how difficult and heavy this experience was upon him. And he was trembling with anxiety and fear, and the famous words that were uttered at that time of Zambuluni, Zambuluni, Dathiruni, Dathiruni. And Sayyidah Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha becomes the pillar of support. And then he's taken to Warqa bin Nawfal, and he is told that yes, you are the last and final, and you promised the last prophet of Allah to come onto earth, but you are going to face immense difficulties and challenges. And subhanAllah, from that point onwards, Allah Akbar, it was just mountains upon mountains of hardship that broke upon the shoulders of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What difficulties he had to undergo, the fact that those people who were his lovers and admirers, and those people who looked up to him, became his arch enemies, and who became his detractors and his foes, and how much of verbal abuses were heard against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the physical abuse that was meted out to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Today, Allah forbid, if somebody has to say something harsh to us for the deen, for the sake of Allah's deen, we become upset, we become angry, we become irritated, we want to react, we want to take some kind of vengeance for that. But Allah, what did Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam go through? But he bore all of that with patience. He was changed away from doors when he knocked at doors. People, he went sometimes more than 5, 6, 7 times to one person in a day. And that person, you came back again. Why are you here again? And Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam persevered through all of that. What hardships. It's unspeakable, it's unbelievable the difficulties that Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went through. That how thorns were placed in his path, how people would stone him, his own beloved uncle, Abu Lahab, in the sense that when he was born, this uncle loved him so much that he set free his slave girl in a sense of gratitude for the birth of this nephew of his. But this uncle, Abu Lahab, who Nabi also loved him because he wanted guidance and hidayat for him, but this uncle was the very opposite of what Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would have expected from an uncle. He became the arch enemy, and we know that what Abu Lahab did, he made his own uncle. He made his sons give talaq to the daughters of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he would follow him everywhere, and he would stone him, and he would abuse him, and people would wonder, what is going on here? His own family is turning against him. Then how can his message be true? And so these were the huge obstacles and hurdles that the Nabi Muhammad faced. We cut in lots of details out of it. We know what happened to him in the affairs of Umar and Virginia and Ubul Majaz and all of these places. All that history, very, very, very heart-wrenching, the history of what the Nabi Muhammad went through in all of those places. There were times when people spat at the Mubarak face of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Quranic verses allude to that. And there were times when Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's Mubarak hair, his beard was full. There were times when Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in sajda, a person placed a rock on his Mubarak body. There were times when a person placed his neck on the neck of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with such force as if he wanted to break the neck of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There were times when the entrails of animals were taken and placed on his Mubarak body, and his body became all soiled as a result of that while he was in the state of sajda in front of Baytullah. And there were times when people threw dust on him and people threw sand on him, and he would be covered in dust, and his daughter Fatima would cry and say that, "Oh my father, what have you done that they are treating you like this?" And the Nabi would console her and say, "Don't worry, oh my daughter, have some patience. All of this we have to go through for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the guidance of people." Then we know the historic event of Ta'if, what happened to him in Ta'if. Allah Akbar. Even the angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were moved by that experience. And they were thirsting for vengeance. And they offered to have the mountains crush those people of Ta'if. Blood was oozing from the Mubarak body of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. His teeth became clogged with that blood. It's easy for us, for me to say these words. It's easy for you to listen to these words. But Allah Akbar, we haven't even perhaps taken a little blow for the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We haven't probably been swallowed for the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But all these experiences Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has gone through. That is why I say, for the suffering ummah of today, no matter where they may be, draw inspiration and take hope and optimism from this uswa and this example of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then we know that what happened to Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companion Shah Abi Talib. For 3 years they were boycotted. There was absolutely social boycott. No interaction with anyone. No, not allowed to leave. No means of survival. No means of provision. They had to eat the leaves of trees. They had to take leather of, you know, of animals and soak it in water until it became soft, and they could chew on that just for survival. For 3 long years, the boycott of Shah Abi Talib took place. Then we know that the suffering of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was exacerbated by the torture that was meted out to his beloved companions. When he saw Bilal suffering and Bilal crying out, Ahadun, 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 do we think it was easy on the heart of our beloved Rasulullah to see his beloved Bilal go through that? How difficult it must have been for him to see Sumayya radiallahu ta'ala anha being martyred, to see Ammar and Yasir, to see all his beloved companions being tortured so brutally. Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw all of that. He went through all of those experiences with them. How it must have weighed heavily on his heart to see all of this. But the mission had to be continued, and he did not deter him from his mission. So then we can go on to the journey of the Hijra itself. Today we know Muslims are making Hijra under dire conditions. We hear about the Rohingya Muslims. They're leaving their country, walking over hundreds of kilometers, walking for days on end, sometimes 2 weeks on end, 3 weeks on end, with absolutely nothing, no food, no clothing, no provisions, no medication, no water. With great difficulty they are able to cross over. We've heard reports of people, eyewitness accounts of people who have gone and come back and been saying that they are so weak that they virtually just tumble on the ground because they don't have the energy to stand anymore. So now look at the Hijra and the difficulties and hardships the Muslims had to undergo in the Hijra. The fact that they were planning and plotting to assassinate him and to kill him. Imagine the greatness of the great. He was facing death threats. His life was in danger. Today, Allah forbid, we get a death threat from someone. And most of the time, it's a hoax thing, because if somebody threatens you, it means he doesn't want to carry it out. Otherwise, if he wants to do it, he'll come and do it. But in the case of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, this was a realistic threat. And his life was in danger. And he went through those dangerous and difficult experiences, putting his full trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, I want to refer to Mawlana Tunara's wonderful presentation. And I think he did more than three quarters of my job in that last slide, when all these lessons, these are the lessons to be really drawn from the hardships and difficulties of the Muslims that he faced, the journey of Hijra, how he had to hide and how he had to take refuge in the cave. And again, his life was in danger at every step. He could have been discovered there, and how he hid there, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed him to escape undetected. And even in the journey itself, the incident of Suraqa and others, that how they almost captured him and taken him as captive, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spared his life, and he came to Medina Munawwara. And now when he settled in Medina Munawwara, we would have said, right, a whole life of oppression and difficulties and hardship has now come to an end, and Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam can now rest in, and have peace and a peaceful, happy, easy existence and life in Medina Munawwara, where all the people were his supporters and people were for him and so on, but nothing of that sort. In fact, when he arrived in Medina Munawwara, the next slide, inshallah, when he arrived in Medina Munawwara, then that was the beginning of another chapter of great difficulties and hardships for Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Without immediately the enmity of those who began to plan and plot and scheme against him, there were assassination attempts against Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We know that how they virtually almost had succeeded in rolling a rock on his Mubarak body, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved him. In due course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved him in seconds, then he managed to walk away before that rock fell. And we know all the other plots that they were making to assassinate and kill Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and how then the enemy began to organize themselves, and the various battles that were spoken about, Mawlana Abdul Rahman spoke about aspects between the battle of Badr and Uhud, Mawlana spoke about Uhud, and I'm sure the other ulama touched upon the various battles that Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam faced. Imagine now, you just finish with one battle and you feel, okay, now it's over, my tests are done and over with, but the next battle comes. The battle of Uhud, amazing thing, immediately after the battle of Uhud, they only returned home.
Sahaba were bleeding from their wounds. They were in great pain. Their bodies were aching and broken. Bones were broken. They were in such difficulty and hardship and the grief and the sorrow of the loss of so many of their companions and friends. But then too, before the Prophet even removed his armor, the call comes out that, O Rasul of Allah, it is not over. The enemies are gathering in Hamra al-Asad and go and face them again in the battlefield. And Allah Akbar, with those broken bones and those wounds that were only with blood, with all of that, they go back into the battlefield. They go back into the battlefield and they face the enemy. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then put so much of awe in the hearts of the enemy. They say, these people are invincible. We can't break them. Their bodies may be broken and bleeding, but you can't break their spirit. Here they are facing us again in the battlefield. And so they escape and they go away. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then gives them some respite at that time. But battle after battle after battle, it's not that it was just one battle. There were 74 expeditions that took place in the time of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, out of which 47, he personally participated in 47 expeditions. Can we imagine? What is the turnaround time in terms of the years he spent in Medina, approximately 10 years or say 11 years? If we divide that by 47, it's almost 4 expeditions per annum that Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was set out into. So this gives us an indication of the kind of difficulties and challenges that he faced. But he did not back down in the face of all of that. He was a mountain of courage and he was a mountain of valor in the face of all of these challenges. And then we see aspects of how so much of fitna was unleashed. The integrity of his beloved family was besmirched at the time of the incident of Ifk. And allegations were made and directed. How doesn't that break the spirit of a person? Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his heart was extremely sensitive. I read in one kitab, my ustad has been Mufti Zubair Bayat, he mentioned this, that to understand what was the extent of the sensitivity of the heart of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, that take the skin of an ordinary human being. It is very sensitive, the skin. But the skin from which the heart is constructed is much more sensitive than the skin of the rest of the body. So now, the bodies of the Anbiya alayhi salam are constructed from the material from which the hearts of ordinary people are constructed. So you can imagine what must be the material from which the hearts of the Anbiya alayhi salam are constructed. And then he goes on to say that the body Mubarak of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was constructed from the material from which the hearts of the Anbiya alayhi wa sallam were constructed. From there you can imagine what must be the level of sensitivity of the heart of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was extremely sensitive. And therefore he mentions, which hadith I wrote in the beginning, he says there that لَقَدْ أُوْزِيْتُ فِي اللَّهِ مَا لَا يُوْزَ أَحَدٍ. I have been tortured and subjected to so much of difficulty and hardship that nobody in Allah's creation was subjected to that kind of difficulty. We look at Noah alayhi salam, he went through so much of hardship. We look at Zakariya alayhi salam, we look at Yahya alayhi salam, we look at the various Anbiya alayhi salam who were martyred, 17 Anbiya who were made shaheed. We look at all of that. But it is no comparison to the hardships of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Because of the sensitivity of his heart, these things bore very heavily upon him. So he went through all of this, his family's honor was destroyed, and efforts were made to divide the community. Masjid al-Dirar was constructed, and we found that he was deserted in the battlefield, like Mawlana mentioned. The hypocrites deserted him at the very crucial moment, and then the martyrdom of his beloved companions. So we find that these were some of the great difficulties and hardships for the Prophet ﷺ faced when he had arrived in Medina Munawwara and he stayed in Medina Munawwara. The plots, the schemes, and then we find that the Prophet ﷺ was given poison, Allahu Akbar. And it was that poison that eventually resulted in his demise. It was a form of martyrdom, in a figurative sense that Allah SWT wanted to accord to his beloved Rasul. So the means of his demise became that very poison that he had, that was fed to him. And not only that, but even black magic or sihr was done upon the Prophet, and that caused a lot of difficulty and hardship. I have given a talk on this subject matter some time ago in the tafsir of the Lord of the Nas. And sometimes we don't understand the extent of how Nabi Muhammad SAW suffered as a result of that sihr. It was not any ordinary suffering. It was very, very difficult. Nabi Muhammad SAW went through a lot of difficulty at the time. For 6 months, he bore the suffering of that sihr and black magic and effect that was done to him by Nabi and the daughters of Nabi. That's one chapter in the history and the sihr of Nabi Muhammad. And then, after all of that, his personal life to Allahu Akbar, look at the poverty of the Islam, which was something that he had by choice adopted and accepted, so that the poor people of the Ummah would not any time feel that who is there for us and what value do we have. In order to keep the hearts of the poor of his Ummah, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam preferred a life of poverty for himself, whereas the mountains around him could have turned into gold for him if he wished so. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala offered these things to him, but he refused any kind of material wealth and benefit, and he chose a life of absolute simplicity, a life of poverty. There were times when there was no food available. There were so many days of hunger. There were so many days of starvation. There were so many difficult moments as far as illness that overtook Nabi Muhammad. I want to mention about the headaches that Nabi Muhammad suffered, the fever that he suffered. The fever that he suffered was not ordinary fever, but in fact it was double the temperature of any ordinary person. That is known from the books of Hadith, that Nabi Muhammad's fever is to be double that of an ordinary person. And his headaches used to be very severe. When Sayyidina Aisha said, "Wa rasa, oh, my head is sore." Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Bal ana wa rasa, my head is much more sore than your head, oh Aisha." And all the martyrdom of his mubarak tooth in the Battle of Uhud, and the blood that oozed out from his mubarak forehead, and his cheek in the Battle of Uhud, and the blood of the Nabi that fell onto the earth. That one drop of blood is more valuable than the whole world and whatever the world contains. But these were all those difficulties and hardships that Nabi Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam endured and went through. So the lesson in all of this again is that O Ummatul Muslimah, if you go through difficulties and hardships, then don't lose heart and do not lose hope, because the Nabi of Allah went through much worse than you went through. Then we take the last moment, and then in between the demise of his daughter, Sayyidina Zainab passes away after the injury that was inflicted upon her mubarak body. His daughters, Ruqayya, Ibn Kulsum, pass away. He buries 3 daughters with his own hand. He buries his sons with his own hand. He buries Ibrahim with his own hand. The tears are flowing. Allahu Akbar. Where did we see a man in the history of the world that besides one of his 7 children, he buries 6 of them with his own hands? Allah. And that daughter of his that survived, you only survived for a matter of a few months after his demise, about 6 months after his demise. And what poverty she went through. What heart, a father can bear his own hardship, but for a father to see his own daughter in her married life going through so much of hardship, that she must carry the water herself, she must move the corn herself, she must sweep the house herself, she must look after the children, she must tend to the animal, she must stoke the fire for cooking the food, collect the firewood. All of these things
Nabi Muhammad saw with his own eyes his beloved daughter, the queen of the women of Jannah, going through all these difficulties and hardships, but he bore all of that for the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that his ummah that will come after him, they would not feel disadvantaged if they have to go through these difficulties and tests. And then comes the last and closing moments of his life too. What difficult sakarat it was upon the Nabi. Even the closing moments of his life was not easy. The mountain of pain that came upon his Mubarak chest, Allah. The ulama saying that he, even at that time, the pain that he was enduring, he did not forget the ummah. And even then he said, oh Allah, let me bear the pain of my whole ummah sakarat, so they don't have to go through that pain. Because if this is the pain, then I would not want my ummah to go through that kind of pain. So even those closing moments were so difficult. And Qusam bin Abbas, according to some narrations, he is the last person to emerge from the Mubarak Qadr of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after his burial. His old family members placed him in the qabr. And the last to emerge was his cousin, the son of his uncle Abbas. And he says that, this is mentioned in, I think, Dalail al-Nubuwwah, one of the Sira Kitabs. He says that as I was leaving, I could hear a murmur from the lips of Nabi Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So I put my ears very close to his Mubarak lips. And what did I hear? What did I hear? What word was he uttering at that time? The word that I heard was, Ummati, 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 Ummati. Even after his demise, the word that came on the lips of beloved Rasulullah was, My Ummah. And as Mawlana said very nicely that, where is this Ummah today? What is the Ummah doing? What role are they playing? After all these difficulties and hardships that Nabi Akram Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam underwent for the sake of his Ummah, preserve his one accepted dua. When every Ambiya, Nabi used up his dua, all the Ambiya used up their dua, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam preserved that one dua for his Ummah on the day of Qiyamah. And he told his Ummah, where are you? You will find me here, you will find me at this place, you will find me here, you will find me here. The great love, the consternation, the worry, the anxiety for his Ummah is what he lived for and what he died for, and what he will be raised up with on the day of Qiyamah. It is now the time for the Ummah to rise up and to become royal Ummatis and to become the real Ummatis that is expected of us to continue the mission of Khatm al-Nubuwwah, to continue the mission of Nabi Akram Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, so that every human being on earth can be introduced to the personality of the greatest being that existed on the surface of this earth, Nabi Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. May Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala accept us to fulfill this responsibility of Khatm al-Nubuwwah, and we become serious and passionate about the work of Da'wah and inviting people to Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala and introducing mankind who is lost to the personality of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and the Ummah of Muslimah who has forgotten the lessons of the seerah of Nabi Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Allah use us for that purpose. And again, I congratulate the organizers of this conference, Mawlana Abdullah Jina Madani, Ladadimu and Hafizahullah, and his companions for organizing this excellent conference. This is really perhaps one of the very inspiring conferences that I've attended, where the focus is directly on the life of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and there's so much to be learned, there's so much to be taken. I did quote one or two ahadith in the beginning. If you allow me, Mawlana, just to do a brief translation of those ahadith, and I promise, inshallah, I conclude on that note. Just three hadiths, or two hadiths. One hadith, which Mawlana also referred to briefly, but perhaps if you get the time to translate it and complete it, so I will do that job, inshallah. أَشَدُّ النَّاسِ بَلَاءً الْأَنْبِيَا ثُمَّ الْأَمْثَلْ فَالْأَمْثَلْ. The people who will be tested most by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the Anbiya alayhimu salam. Indeed, they were tested like no one else, and then those who will be closer in resemblance to them. And the more closer a person is in resemblance to Anbiya alayhimu salam, the more that person is going to be tested by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if a believer is tested by Allah, he should never become despondent or lose hope, but he should feel honored, and he should feel, in fact,
we should feel a sense of gratification that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has reserved for me that which has reserved for the most beloved servant, Rabbi alayhi wa salatu wa salam. It is said about Khaja Qutbuddin Bakhtiyar Kaki rahmatullah alayhi, great wali of Allah, buried in Delhi. He would say that the day I do not undergo any difficulty or hardship, it is a very difficult and hard day for me because I feel Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has turned away from me. Why isn't some guest of difficulty or hardship visiting my door today from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So that was the one narration. And the second narration, for the Ummah at large, when you see all this bloodshed and we see this massacre and we see this genocide and ethnic cleansing and the killing and the brutality, the torture, people are being buried alive under the bulldozers and people are being burnt alive and they've been shot and they've been hacked into pieces and they've been moved. What conditions are facing the Ummah of Nabi Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? So what lesson do we take out of this? That is the last hadith I want to quote, and here we find that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentioned, and this is narrated by Abu Musa or Abu Darra radiallahu ta'ala anhu in the book Abu Dawud Sharif. The narration comes, Ummati hadihi ummatun marhuma. This ummah of mine, it is an ummah that has been enveloped in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Laysa alayha adhabun fil akhirah. There won't be any severe punishment for this ummah in the akhirah. There might be some light retribution for those people who will really overstep the mark, but even they will not be subjected to that severe torment that the disbelievers will face. So this ummah laysa laha adhabun fil akhirah. Most of them will escape from adab in the akhirah because of Allah's special mercy on this ummah. But what will happen? They will pay a little price in this world. The price they will pay in this world, what will be that price? Adabuha fil dunya. The adab of my ummah will be in this world. They will go through some hardship and suffering. They will pay for some of their misdeeds and misdemeanors. Not all. مَا أَصَابَكُمْ مِنْ مُصِيبَةٍ فَبِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ وَيَعْفُوا عَنْ كَثِيرٍ. Many will be forgiven. Much will be forgiven. But a little bit of hardships we will face. And what are those hardships? The Prophet ﷺ described them in few words. Al-fitan. Some major challenges and fitnas and mischief that you will face. That is one. And the second thing, al-zalazil. Earthquakes and some kind of natural disasters and catastrophes will befall them. And the third thing he mentioned, al-qatl. There will be bloodshed and killing and massacres and so on. But this will be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's way and method of cleansing and purifying this marhum ummah, this ummah that is the ummah of rahmah and mercy. With these words I conclude. Jazakumullahu khair for affording me this opportunity and listening very carefully and attentively. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the lessons of the seerah. Wa asr da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.